Dear friends, I greet you all in Jesus' almighty name, and it is a great privilege that God has given to me to reach out to you this day with the Word of God to you, friends of the Lifeboat Fellowship. And I wish to thank Mr. Alvin and Mr. Nitin for connecting with me. Dear friends, I've been praying very much for you all and for this Zoom meeting. And the burden that God gave to me is to preach upon one particular point. Let us run the race set before us, looking unto Jesus. Let us run the race set before us, looking unto Jesus. Just to bank my message upon a particular portion of the scripture, let me read to you Hebrews 12 chapter, first three verses. Therefore, seeing we also are surrounded with a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily ensnare us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such hostility of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your own minds. I wish to present this message to you under five subheadings. The first point is the cloud of witnesses. Here, the writer to Hebrews says, therefore, seeing we also are surrounded with a great cloud of witnesses. If you read Hebrews 11 chapter, you'll find a list of the Old Testament saints who have been able to look to God in faith, beginning from Abel till the last saint of the Old Testament. These people had been focused upon God. They were looking to God in faith, and also they were listening to God's word. These Old Testament saints died in faith, knowing that something more better than what they had is reserved for us. If we read Hebrews 11 chapter verses 39 and 40, and these all, having obtained a good report of faith from God, received not the promise, God having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. When we look at the scriptures, when we look at the Bible, all the people of God in the Old Testament and also the New Testament had been put as a family. Here we see that the people of faith of the Old Testament did not receive what God promised, because something more better than what they had has been waiting for us, a cloud of witnesses. Now, let us look at the Old Testament witnesses, beginning from Abel to the last prophet in the Old Testament. Also, look at the martyrs from the beginning of the first century till date. Many saints have been standing for the Lord. Many have died for the Lord. So when we talk about the cloud of witnesses, we must understand that we have to look at the Old Testament saints and also all the witnesses, all the real servants of God, beginning from the first century till today. There are great servants of God who are serving the Lord even today in many parts of the world. Now, at the same time, there are people who preach God's word for money. People who preach prosperity gospel just to enhance their own prosperity. Let us not worry about them. They will have to answer God and they will land in hellfire if they do not repent for what they have been doing. When we look at the cloud of witnesses, it can give to us sufficient impetus and motivation to lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, to run the race that is set before us. The second subsection that I want to place before you is this: lay aside every weight and the sin. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily ensnare us. This calls for decision. I would say that our desires determine our decisions, and our decisions determine our destiny and destination. So when the options are before us, let us look at the cloud of witnesses and then lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Weight, the word is onkos, meaning whatever is prominent, a protuberance, some bulk that we are not able to carry along. So when we look at our own personal lives, we are surrounded by a lot of problems. Now, this COVID-19 has been bringing a lot of havoc throughout the whole world. Now, we as believers, how to manage this situation? So the problems that we face is like a bulk, like a protuberance. We have to lay aside and then run the race that is set before us, looking to God. We all have many burdens say for example financial, familial, societal, and also in a global situation, a lot of problems are there. And you know, all of us have been facing this problem of COVID-19, and this causes a lot of problems in individual lives and also families. I want to list a few points that will make you understand the problems that we face in our families and our personal lives. For example, the first point is emotional violence in families. Because of this COVID-19 throughout the world, a lot of problems are there. Some of the family members are not able to meet their parents. Even within the family, parents and children come under tension. Tension is there, and I would call it emotional violence. Emotional violence. So when we have this type of situation, what happens is sometimes emotional violence brings in physical violence. Especially when parents are having problems, emotional violence, they get angry with the children sometimes. So this emotional violence can bring in physical violence. Because of the emotional violence as well as physical violence, sorrow and peacelessness enters into the family. Many people, many families suffer in these areas, and also many people suffer because of economic violence. Some people do not get their salary in full measure. Lot of problems are there. We have to understand the situation in the presence of God, whether it is emotional violence or physical violence or economic violence, God has a remedy. If you are facing economic violence, I want you to understand one point that I want to place before you as to how to deal with this situation. I call it God's economy of equality. God is able to supply all our needs provided we seek God and His kingdom first and His righteousness first. When we look to God in faith and walk a life of faithfulness, keeping a conscience clean, God can supply all our needs. Now, in my personal life, I have seen God working in and through me to preach this word to people. I want to tell something about God's economy of equality. Now, it is God who supplies all our needs. I don't believe in prosperity gospel, but what is needed for us, God is able to supply. But what we should have in our heart is a heart of compassion to help people who are in need. As we are the children of God, when we look at people who are in need, we must have a heart of compassion to hand over what is possible to help such people. Then God's economy of equality shall be ours. When we help people who are in need, God is able to provide what is needed for us. In my personal life, God has been giving me a heart of compassion to help people who are in need. As the Spirit of God leads me, I try to help people who are poor. I don't expect anything back from them, but I have joy in helping people who are in need. If you are suffering from emotional violence, physical violence, and economic violence, it is imperative that you reach out to God in faith and obey what God wants you to obey, so that all these problems will be solved. So the Word of God says, lay aside every weight. Let me read to you from Peter's epistle, 1 Peter 5th chapter 7th verse. Cast all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Cast, the word cast, in Greek it is epiripto. Epiripto means taking our problems, throwing at the feet of the Lord, taking our hands off. Place in the presence of God, take your hands off. It is imperative that we take all our problems and lay it before the presence of God. Take our hands off from that burden so that God will take care of us. The Word of God says, cares for you. He cares for you. The particular phrase in Greek is melei perihumon. The meaning is, He will take care of you over and above, in and around, all over you. He will take care of you in that situation. So, God loves us so much, He can take care of us. But what we need to understand is, by faith and obedience, lay all on the altar. Cast all in the presence of God. Years back, maybe 60 or 65 years back, before the bus came, people used to use bullock cart to carry their own burdens and also to travel here and there. When the buses came, what happened was people were finding it something very new. One uneducated person, he got into a bus, paid the money for the ticket, sat in his seat, kept the burden that he was carrying, kept his bag that he was carrying upon his head. See, this is what many people do. When God says, lay all on the altar, cast all your cares on Him, we like to cast everything on Him. As I told you, casting is throw upon, place upon, take your hands off. This is what we have to do. This can be done only when we have trust in God. So the word of God says, see that you are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight. When we trust in God, looking at the cloud of witnesses, it will be easy for us to do this dictum. In one mountainous area, people are building a road and the foreman was there, laborers were there. They were cutting down the trees and paving the way for the road to be built. As a laborer was trying to cut down a tree, he heard the chirping of small birds in a nest in that particular tree. He just climbed up. He found small birds that have not opened their eyes yet, keeping their mouth open. They were just chirping there. He got so compassionate. He came down. He told his foreman they did not cut the tree. So they had to bifurcate the road and then move forward. After a few months, this particular person who did not cut that tree, he was coming that way. He wanted to go up and look at the nest of those birds. And when he climbed there, the nest was broken. The birds have already flown away. But what he found there really surprised him. He found a small piece of paper onto which was written, "In God we trust." When the birds were building the nest, they have brought the small paper. They couldn't read, but the paper said, "In God we trust." The word of God says, God takes care of sparrows. So if God can take care of sparrows, we are more valuable than many sparrows. So dear friends, let me just encourage you to look to him in faith. Seeing that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight. And then the next point is sin that easily enslaves us. Besetting is euperistatos in Greek, meaning skillfully surrounding us. The word of God says that lust of the eyes and lust of flesh and pride of life are not from God, they are of this world. So Satan wants to enslave us. So the word of God says skillfully surrounding us, the sin that skillfully surrounds us. Satan will never go down the street and say, "Look here guys, I am Satan." He would never say that. He hides behind lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh and also pride of life. So when these things come, we must understand that they are skillfully surrounding us. We are believers, no doubt about it, but still we have to understand this point. The word of God encourages us to lay aside every weight and the sin that skillfully surrounds us. Often many believers, so-called believers, who are not able to grow in the spiritual grace, who are not able to walk in the Spirit of God, they have no desire to leave these sweet evil things that are surrounding them. Years back, I read about a small boy who was playing with a marble in his hand. And there was a flower vase, it was an empty flower vase, and he put the marble inside. He wanted to take it out. He put his hand inside. The hand could go into the flower vase, but when he took hold of the marble, he was not able to take his hand out. But he was holding onto the marble, and he began to scream and cry. His daddy came and said, "Sonny, what's happening?" And this little boy said, "Daddy, I want to take the marble out." Then the dad understood the situation and told the young boy, "You just relax your fingers and your hand can come out." He said, "No, Daddy, I want the marble out." This is what's happening in the lives of many people. Sins are sweet. They keep it under their own tongue. They go on munching it. The word of God says, sin may be very sweet for you, but when we munch it, keeping it under your own tongue, when it goes into the system, it will become the poison of adders, poison of vipers. We must be careful to understand this. So as the word of God says, seeing that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that skillfully surrounds us. Then we would be in a position to run the race that is set before us. The third subsection is, look to Jesus and run with patience the race that is set before you. So the word of God says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking into Jesus. When Jesus came into this world, taking upon him the human flesh, he was like a man, but he knew no sin, had no sin, did no sin. He was obeying God the Father, and he was willing to do what God wanted him to do. So Jesus is a beginner and perfecter of our faith. So he was able to run the race that was set before him. He was able to present before us the highest example of faith. So it is imperative we have to follow Jesus and run the race that is set before us. Looking to Jesus is very important. As we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us understand their lives and learn from them. At the same time, we have to look to Jesus and run the race. He is the beginner and perfecter of our faith. Now, when we try to follow the Lord Jesus, we have to grow in faith. At the same time, faith will be of no use when we reach heaven. So, till we reach heaven, faith should be in us. The Word of God says, look to Jesus and run with patience the race that is set before us. We have to look at Jesus. In the ministerial realm, there are many great men of God and women of God who are serving God. We can learn from them, but we cannot look at them as heroes and heroines. We are to look to Jesus and run the race that is set before us. The Word of God says, look at Jesus. Look to Jesus. Now, looking is aphoro in Greek, meaning to turn our eyes away from other things and fix our eyes upon God. I want to tell you that we are not looking at things with our eyes alone. We look at things through our eyes from the heart. See, if you look at a camera, the lens are there, the software is inside. So, we look at things through our eyes, but from our heart. We must understand that. When I was studying in Palayankottai, when I was doing my BSc in St. Xavier's College, at the back of our hostel, there was a blind school. And many blind people used to walk on the road. One evening, myself and my friend, we were walking on the road, and two men were coming before us. They, blind men, they had a stick in their hand. They tap it on the tar road and the side so that they would know which way they are walking. So they were walking along and a girl was going in a cycle. At that time, girls will not go in cycle. But in Palayankottai, many girls used to go in cycle. These two blind men were coming towards us. And this one blind one was telling the other fellow, Parupa, Punnu poo vachittu cycle abodhu. Look, here is a girl who is cycling and going, keeping a bunch of flowers in her hair. How could this blind man understand a girl was going in a cycle, keeping a bunch of flowers in her head? He heard this cycling noise, pedaling noise. At the same time, he was able to smell the whiff of the flowers, jasmine flowers, that this girl was keeping in her head. So, I want to tell you, we look at things from our heart, through our eyes. We are to look at Jesus and understand His eyes. If you read Songs of Solomon, chapter 5, and let me read to you verse 12, it speaks about, symbolically speaks about the eyes of the Lord Jesus. His eyes are as eyes of doves by the rivers of waters, washed with milk and fitly set. A beautiful expression to understand how we should have our eyes. So Jesus' eyes were like the eyes of dove by the rivers of water. When we look at the Holy Spirit, He is symbolically expressed as a dove. So, dove by the rivers of water. Rivers of water also speaks about the Holy Spirit. So, Jesus' eyes were like that. What can we understand from this? Our eyes must be cleansed by the river of life, by the Holy Spirit. Our hearts must be cleansed. After salvation, we like to grow in holiness. When our hearts are washed by the living waters, when the Holy Spirit is living in us, our eyes will be very clear. Washed with milk and fitly set. Washed with milk means milk is the Word of God. So, when we are saved, we have to keep our hearts right before God based upon the Word of God. And also fitly set. So, the eyes of Jesus is like the eyes of dove by the rivers of water. Washed with milk and fitly set. We can have, we should have, we should long to have the eyes like that of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to tell a few points about several types of eyes, different types of eyes. First, I want to tell about eyes of predators. Eyes of predators, say for example, a tiger or a lion, they have their eyes in the front. The eyes are bifocal. So, two eyes are in the front. Like tiger and lion, we have bifocal eyes. Since we have bifocal eyes, we are able to see the distance between us and an article that is before us. Imagine a man who is driving a motorcycle. Suppose if he has one eye, he would not know the distance between him and another car that is coming before him. So when we have bifocal eyes, we can understand the distance. These predators have bifocal eyes, so when they chase their own prey, a cattle or a deer, when they chase these animals, they are able to look at the distance between them and the animal and the prey. They are able to chase and kill the prey and eat them. We have bifocal eyes. We are not supposed to run away from the enemy. We are not supposed to run away from Satan. Many people, when they fall in sin, they say, Satan attacked us. If you are walking in the light of God, why should Satan attack you? How can Satan attack you? Let him do his work. What is needed? We should have the bifocalize to look to Jesus and look at the path that God has designated for us. We need not run away from the enemy. We have to chase the enemy. The enemy should run away from us. If you look at the eyes of the cattle, they do not have bifocal eyes, but the eyes are at the side of their own head. So when they run away from predators, when they look, if they have to look back, they tilt their head a little, so the bulging eyes can see 180 degrees. If they tilt this side, it can see 180 degrees. Looking at the predators, they try to run away. We have eyes in the front. We have bifocal eyes. We must be able to look at God. We must be able to look at the path that God has designated for us and run the race that is set before us. There are people who have chameleon's eyes. The chameleons have two eyes. With one, they can look in the front. With another, they can look at the back. Many people have chameleon's eyes. They look at God when they come to church, but when they go away from the church, they look at the world. We must not have chameleon's eyes. We have bifocal eyes, and we must be in a position to run the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus. We should not have chameleon's eyes. There is a small fish called anableps anableps. These fish, they float in the water, very small fish. They have oval eyes, two oval eyes, and four lenses are there. The lens above can look at the air. Lens below can look under the water. This little fish anableps can use the lens above to look at the enemy. Look at the falcon or some other birds. They try to fly and capture it. At the same time, with the eyes below the water, it can look at the enemy that might chase it under the water. Maybe a snake or other big fish, it can escape. We must have eyes like anableps. After salvation, we must be able to fix our hearts upon the things above, where Christ is dwelling. We must keep our eyes there at the same time. When we walk in this world, we must have eyes like that of the anableps to understand the path of God. So, understand the things of God that are waiting for us in heaven. At the same time, we have to walk in the path of God that God has designated for us in this world. The word of God says, look at Jesus and run the race that is set before us. For every one of us, every believer, God has a specific plan. We must be able to understand and do God's will. Often many people, after they receive salvation, they walk in the path that they have set for themselves. It is not what God wants. God has a specific plan for us. When we do God's will, when we walk in the path that God has designated for us, we will never miss the mark. Years back, when the Europeans went to USA to settle there, and when the USA was being built at that time, some white men, they were going into a new area. It was all snow-covered area. They wanted to go to a particular place, and they were walking on the snow. No proper roads were there. As they were walking on the snow, they did not understand the path that they have to follow. As they were walking along, suddenly they found that many others have been walking in the same path. They said, well, many people had walked this way, so they began to follow that path. After half an hour or so, they found more footprints there. Then they said, we are on the right path. They were walking along, but they were not able to go and reach their destination. In that confused state, there's an American Indian who was standing near a tree, leaning on the tree. He looked at this white man and said, white men go round and round. This is what many people do. Once you are saved, you must understand the path that God has designated for us. So the word of God says, seeing that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that doth so easily beset us. Let us run the race that is set before us. God has set a specific path for us, a specific way for us, specific will for us. We have to understand it and walk with patience. Patience is hupomone in Greek, meaning steadfastness, constancy, and also endurance. As believers, we have to understand the path that God has designated for us and run with patience. As we understand the path that God has designated for us, and as we run with patience, often Satan tries to hinder us. He tries to deviate us from the path. We must be careful. The word of God says, seeing that you are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that easily enslaves us, the sin that skillfully surrounds us. Let us run the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the beginner and perfecter of our faith. It is imperative that we look to Jesus and run the race. The fourth subsection that I want to place before you is this. Jesus is our example to face suffering and then be glorified. The Word of God says, Jesus, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. When Jesus Christ came into this world, he had to take upon him the human body to suffer for us and die for us and then rise again. He had to face a lot of hostility from the people around him. He was facing a lot of sorrows. At the same time, he was able to endure those things because of the joy that was set before him. What was the joy that Jesus had before him? Jesus was co-eternal Son of God, who was with God the Father all through eternity. When Jesus came into this world, he had to be away from his Father. And there is nobody who could interact with him in the right perspective to understand him. God the Father was in heaven and Jesus was on this earth. Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, came into this world to die for us. And he was separated from God the Father to some extent. And after he would complete his work, he would go back to God the Father and be with him. That was a joy that was set before him. Jesus chose the 12 disciples and trained them up for 3.5 years. And after death and resurrection, Jesus met them. Jesus spoke to them and said, all power is given unto me. Go into all the world and preach the word of God and make disciples. Jesus knew that his church would be built and many souls will be saved. And this was a joy that is set before him. When the heaven is full of souls that are saved, Jesus will be so happy. The word of God says, when one sinner repents, there is joy in heaven. When that particular sinner is saved, still more joy in heaven. When the saved sinner becomes a disciple, more joy in heaven. When the saved disciple brings more souls into the kingdom of God, still more joy in heaven. So the word of God says, Jesus was able to suffer. He was able to endure the suffering because of the joy that is set before him. We should be able to look to Jesus and run the race that is set before us so that we would be so happy when we reach heaven. He is our example, so that we would be able to look to God in faith and also understand the joy that is set before us and run the race. The fifth point that I want to place before you is this. Think about Jesus and the joy that is set before us. The Word of God says, consider Jesus who endured such hostility of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your own minds. When we try to follow the Lord Jesus, there will be opposition. When we consider Jesus and run the race that is set before us, there will be contradictions. Unsaved people will bring contradictions. Even saved people, if they are not able to walk in the presence of God, when they become unspiritual, they also would bring contradiction in our own personal lives. How to understand it? What we should do? I would encourage all of you to keep a humble frame of mind, keep a clean conscience and have faith. Contradictions will be there. Oppositions will be there. At the same time, when you walk in the path of God, He is able to guide us. When we are in God's will, there will be oppositions. There will be suffering. At the same time, when we consider Jesus the beginner and perfecter of our faith and run the race that is set before us, definitely He would be able to be with us and make us succeed in our own path. We would be able to endure the suffering like Jesus, because of the joy that is set before us. What is the joy that is set before us? Jesus told the disciples, let not a heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I'd have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. So when we are born again, when we are walking in the presence of God, Jesus prepares a mansion for us. That is a joy that is set before us. The life in this world is transitory, transient, and that passes away. We are to leave this world one day and go into eternity. The joy that is set before us is that there is a mansion that is being prepared by the Lord Jesus for us. When you try to bring one soul into the kingdom of God, you may have some part in that process. But later, when you go to heaven, such souls will come and tell you, brother, you spoke to me on that day. I was born again. I'm here in heaven because of you. And you know, that's a great joy. So when we gather souls for the kingdom of God, in heaven there is eternal joy. Though we may have to go through struggles and problems, it is God who is able to guide us. Sufferings may be there, sufferings will be there. But when we look at the joy that is set before us, we would endure such suffering and then fulfill the purpose and plans that God has set for us. I want to talk to you about Peter's daughter. Peter was a great man of God, a great apostle, and his daughter's name was Petronilla. She was a very beautiful girl. She had a problem. Her hands and her feet were not able to work properly. She had problem there. Pain would be there. And she'll be always lying down. One day, it seems, a few guests came to Peter's house. And Peter told this girl, his daughter Petronilla, come on, get up and then serve them. Serve food for them. So with much struggle, she got up, served food for them, then came and lay down again. And the guests were a little confused and they said, Peter, you were able to heal many people. Even your shadows fell upon people and they were healed. Why your daughter is not healed? Peter very coolly said, God knows what to do with her. He has his own plans. He will do what is his perfect will. Later what happened was, this girl Petronilla was praying and the Lord touched her and she was totally healed. Her hands and her feet were totally healed. And as she was a beautiful girl, there was one young man whose name was Valerius Flaccus. He was a Roman nobleman. He saw her and he wanted to marry her. And he came and made the proposal. Petronilla knew that if she marries this particular nobleman who was a Roman, she would be really grieving God. She knew that she would not be in a position to live for the Lord Jesus after marrying him. So she was prompted by the Holy Spirit. She told him, you come after 3 days and take me away. Come after 3 days and carry me away. So within the 3 days, what happened was, she was praying. When Valerius Flaccus, the nobleman, came with his friends to take her away for marriage after 3 days, when he came, he found that she was dead. So this girl Petronilla knew that if she marries this particular man, she would be leaving the Lord Jesus Christ. She would not be able to live properly as a child of God. So she submitted herself to God. The Lord took her away in time. She went to be with the Lord in heaven. So, dear friends, the plans and purposes that God has set for you will be fulfilled. What is our duty? What is your duty? Seeing that you're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that easily entangles us. Let us run the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the beginner and perfecter of our faith. In closing, let me just place before you a word that will encourage you. If you read Hebrews 13, chapter 5th verse, there the Lord Jesus said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Friends, I tell you, when you walk in the path that has been designated by God the Father, He will never leave us nor forsake us. He will be with us. So, let us follow the dictum. Therefore, seeing we also are surrounded with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that easily entangles us. Run the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the beginner and perfecter of our faith. Years back, I read about a boy who longed to build a small boat. He bought all the materials needed. He built a boat in wood and he set a sail there. He took it to a seashore. He put it in the water. It began to float there. He was so happy. And it had a sail. It was moving forward. As he was so happy about the boat that he prepared, suddenly a big wave came and the boat was lost. He was so unhappy, he began to cry. And after a few days, as he was walking along a road, he looked at a shop. He was able to see his boat inside the shop. He ran into the shop and spoke to the shopkeeper and said, this is my boat, I made it. And the shop owner said, I don't know whether you made it or not. I bought it from a fisherman. This particular fisherman was fishing. This boat got entangled in the net and he just took it and sold it to this shop owner. This shop owner said, I bought this boat for 500 rupees. If you bring 500 rupees, I'll give the boat to you. This boy said, please keep it with you. Let me earn some money and bring the money to you. This little boy began to gather money by doing odd jobs. And when he was able to gather 500 rupees, he came running and said, please give the boat to me. And the shop owner gave the boat to him. This boy brought the boat to his own house. He hugged it and said, I created you. I lost you. I bought you back. You belong to me. I will never let you go. Dear friends, it is what God wants to tell you today. I created you. I lost you. I purchased you with my blood. And you belong to me. I will never leave you. I have known the Lord Jesus Christ for the past 52 years. The Lord has been with me. So, dear friends, it is imperative that we look to God in faith, seeing that you're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin that easily entangles us. Let us run the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the beginner and perfecter of our faith. The joy that is set before us. I have a joy that is set before me. When I go into heaven, I will be able to see the Lord Jesus Christ, and also I will be able to meet many souls whom I have helped to come closer to the Lord Jesus. So, dear friends, the Lord bless you this day. Shall we look to God in prayer? Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, and praise you for the joy that is given to us to listen to your voice. With the burden that you gave to me, O God, I have shared your word to these dear friends. I pray, O Lord, that you may lay your hands upon every brother, every sister, every child, every young man, every infant, the whole group. Everyone should be touched by your God. Lay your hands upon them and bless them. Let them understand the word of God that they heard today. Let them imbibe the word of God, live the word of God, and live a victorious life, O Lord. We are surrounded by problems, but help us to understand that the joy that is set before us, looking at Jesus, the beginner and perfecter of our faith, help us to run the race that is set before us, O Lord. There are many people who are not saved. They are wallowing in sinful lives, O Father. Give all of us a heart of compassion, a heart full of burden for souls, so that we would be able to run the race that is set before us, bringing souls to your kingdom, O God. Father, niye lahanatol kabi. Itene hiye mahton kabuladi antuni. Iten kenami lamakon kabil kabali antuni. Father, niye lahanatol kabi lehini. Lay your hands upon everyone who heard your word today. Bless everyone, O Lord. Pour into their hearts a heart of compassion, the spirit of compassion, so that they would serve thee, O God. When we try to follow you, problems will be there, O Lord. At the same time, let these dear friends understand that you have designated great joy for them in heaven, and you are able to give them grace, O Father. Let the grace of God and the presence of God continue to be with them. Let the word of God that they heard today be in their own hearts, O Father. Let them come closer to you and continue to look to you in prayer, so that they would definitely be blessed, O God. In Jesus' almighty name I pray. Amen. The Lord be with you, friends, and bless you. Amen.